little after 7:30, so how about we start? The goal tonight is we'd like to end this 9:30, so maybe even at the 9:35, so we're starting a couple minutes late here. So I'm going to welcome everyone to another information session on Water District Proposed Number 5, and also I see there's a couple people here from also on Water District 3, so we will just touch a couple pieces on that, but mostly it is for Water District 5. Just so everyone knows who we have here tonight, sitting up here, we have Joe Moriello, attorney, we have Dan Torres from the town board, we have Tim Rogers, the mayor of New Paltz, we have Marty Irwin, also from the town board, Russell Urban Mead, who is hydrologist the hydrologist on the project, Dave Clouser, engineer for the town of New Paltz, and also the engineer for the project. We have George Rodenhausen, who will be here. He's an attorney who many of you might know, who does a lot of our CEQA and also with our planning board. We have Tom Rocco, town board. Dave Mertzig, we have here, also from attorney for the village. Thank you. Attorney for the village, who does a lot of work in the water. We also have Dan Machard in the back and Todd West from the DEP. And we have Don Kerr over in the back there too, also from the village board. So I think I've introduced everybody. What we're gonna do is we have a presentation, and the presentation is going to be involved on where we are, how we got here, and what the plans are. What we'd like to do is while we're going through the presentation, we prefer not to try to answer any questions during the presentation. There is a lot of material that they have organized in an order, so if you can hold your questions, that would help us a lot. It would help everyone here a lot. I know it would help some of the members here, too, that are also new to this project. What we'd like to also do is have questions at the end, then. So we're more than happy to take questions at the end. Everyone could limit your question to a question or two and try not to exceed 5 minutes. We have a lot of people here. We will try to answer everything we can. We've assembled a lot of people here to answer questions. Those we can't, and the reason we assembled so many people is we will also take these questions back and we will write them down and then get them back out to everyone. If a question's been asked, let's try not to ask it again, and again, just in the interest of time. And again, we'd really like to try to get this meeting done in 2 hours, because after that, we're finding we get a lot of meeting fatigue. So with that said, let's start with the presentation.
Our purpose really is to give some information but also get more questions. As many know, we've put together 40 questions and answers from questions that we've collected. We have some more that we got from a group in the neighborhood that we just got those answered barely before the meeting. But the purpose is really to collect any questions that you have and be able to give you as much information as we can on the district. I can't guarantee you that we'll have an answer to every question, but I can guarantee you that we can answer that at a meeting or at a board meeting at a later time.
Dave, do you mind speaking in the microphone just for the video as well?
We have some information on the groundwater sources and capabilities. Russell is here for that. There's an overview of the requirements of the water district that will be coming up. We want to talk about the anticipated water costs. And then we're going to try to keep the presentation short, so there's plenty of time for questions. One of the main questions, many of the main questions that's come up is, has to do with the aquifer. Those are really good questions, they're important questions. I asked Russell here, who is the hydrogeologist on the project, to be able to go over where we're at and to be able to answer some of the questions that we've had so far. Some of those are description of the aquifer, what feeds it, how do we know it's capable of the supply requirements, what's expected of the stability of its quality, what's the rate of withdrawal proposed, and what rate can be maintained long term. Those are all good questions. They all deserve a good answer. And I think Russell will be able to give quite a few of those answers. I'll turn it over to Russell.
With apologies for those of you who have seen these slides before, in case there were some fresh faces, it made sense to back up a little bit and get on to the questions. My assignment as a hydrogeologist reporting to the project team was to see if we could find groundwater sources capable of providing several hundred gallons a minute. And our first step was to basically sort the soils in the town by type. And very quickly, one sees that there are areas on the east side that have some yellow, which are the more sand and gravel type deposits. And there are some of those yellow soils in the bed of the in the valley, the Walk Hill, and nowhere else. Rock wells will reliably produce water typically in the 5, 10, up to 40, 50 gallons a minute, but when you're trying to put together several hundred gallons a minute, the first place to start is gravel. It has high permeability, it recharges more quickly, and so sometimes a single source or just one or two sources can meet a project demand, so it's where we like to start. And we did some exploration on the east side of town and did not find deep gravel that could be exercised. So the majority of our effort was spent in the Walk Hill. The angles are slightly different here, but that's black and white aerial of the Walk Hill Valley, kind of top to bottom as it traverses through the town of New Paltz. And every place there's a yellow dot, which I apologize, you may not be able to see, but any place there's a yellow dot, any place there's a property that's outlined in red with white cross hatches, those are parcels where permission was received to do test borings. It was for those of you who watched us, starting in the winter of 2013 and proceeding into the spring, late spring and midsummer of 2014, you know that we were present drilling everywhere looking for gravel. We ended up identifying a buried bedrock gorge under the center of the Walk Hill Valley, a place where the depth to rock was significantly greater than it was in the average area of the flats. And in some select areas, we found that that valley, otherwise largely filled with glacial lake clay, contained gravel. So we ended up with a hydrogeologic model or conceptual model of the valley that looked like this, where the red dashed lines are where, the boundaries of that valley, and the purple lines are that buried gorge that are as much as 200 feet below the level of the current valley. And in the center of the figure, there's a section of that valley that underneath deep blue impermeable clay was a nice bed of sand and gravel that was thickest in this location and thinned to the north, and we were not able to find it to the south. And so after having investigated from the north end to pretty much the south end of areas within a reasonable proximity of where it was needed, we ended up putting in test wells at 101 Plains Road after having evaluated test wells here. And clearly the yield potential was greatest here. When we put in the test wells, some of you know this well, the way that the process works, you put in a test well and you want to know what the potential yield may be. So there was step test, evaluating a couple different rates. That also taught us that some of the nearby homeowners had particularly shallow wells. That led us to community meetings. That led us to a preparation for a test that would be a health department and DEC approved capacity test with some mitigation measures in place to try to get the community near this source through the test period. And to this day, I will be grateful to the many of you who participated and allowed us to monitor your water levels and mitigate and get us through the test period. So thank you. The geologic cross-section that we've assembled, kind of showing a section through here, shows the depth of that gorge, shows the sand and gravel under the thick clay, recognizes that there are some extensions, that whenever we found them were typically less than 10 feet thick of sand and gravel also under clay, that on top of the clay there's a thin coat of sand and gravel. A few people have existing cistern type wells that are, draw water from on top of the clay. Some residents have what to me are the most common style wells in the Hudson Valley, you know, drilled wells that are usually 100 and a half, 200 feet or more deep. And some residents have wells that terminate at bedrock and tap that thin sand and gravel lens. So there are a number of different well configurations. So one of the considerations always is when you're pumping is where's the recharge to a source? It does no good to find a isolated pocket of water and pump it out and then leave it there and have it never refill. That serves no purpose. And so the test certainly demonstrated to us, as did visual inspection of the clay, that the Wallkill River does not leak through its bed through 100 feet of clay down to the sand and gravel underneath. But the water quality underneath was a good, fresh quality of water, had high dissolved oxygen, certainly didn't have any characteristics of stale water. Reasonable interpretation is that rainfall on the hillside to the west and to the east of the clay would be areas that receive the same 38 to 40 inches of precipitation every year that every other place in the region does. And a portion of that enters the ground, and a portion of that is evidently supporting the sand and gravel at depth. So the assignment was not to identify a long-term sustainable discharge rate. The assignment was to provide a source of water for 10-week shutdown periods. If those had been the same number, that would have been nice, but if this test demonstrated that that wasn't the case. The step test demonstrated that the well could provide 400 gallons a minute, which is what, after looking at some of the other available sources, was a desirable goal. And in conversation with the DEC and the health department, we learned that it's acceptable to conduct a test that would prove up a source of water that would be used for a short period of time at an accelerated pumping rate and then allow it to recover. So that was the basis of the design of the test. The test was conducted at 400 gallons a minute for 72 hours, exceeding the health department minimum requirement is 72. The difference is only because of logistics, not because we had 2 hours of doubt. We then followed it up with 25 hours with only one of the two test pumps running, both to, at a very preliminary level, learn something about a lower rate that could contribute to future conversations about sustainable long-term uses of this resource, and also to allow us to continue observing drawdown and well influence around the well field. The water quality samples collected at the end of the test were just terrific water, aside from disinfection. The primary well is ready to serve. What we'd like to see as hydrogeologists from a sustainable source, in other words, when it's being pumped at a rate that could be authorized for 365-day-a-year use, is recovery in a couple days. This well reached 90% recovery in something like 17 days, and as time passed, reached full recovery. That didn't surprise me, because we knew that we were going into the test pumping at a rate that likely exceeded the long-term sustainable rate, which once again was not the assignment, not the purpose of the test, but this confirmed that. This confirmed that the formation adequately refilled itself, but refilled itself more slowly than it had been pumped out. So it took longer to recover, but it did recover. The greatest drawdown, not surprisingly, followed the alignment of the sand and gravel in that deep gorge. So the primary alignment of drawdown, these dotted lines or dashed lines, are areas of interpreted equal drawdown. So we saw the water levels in available wells, and there aren't very many drilled in this area, but in our two test wells, and we had a well on the other side of the river near the bridge, we had the drawdown recorded in those locations, and so we drew some reasonable interpretation of this is the 50 feet of drawdown and greater. This becomes the 30 foot drawdown and greater, and we started picking up some wells in the neighborhood that experienced 30 feet or more of drawdown in domestic wells. And then this was the kind of extent of areas where what our network of more than 50 residential wells that we were sampling throughout the test, this is just a snapshot of wells being monitored, taught us that these wells were the ones that were drawn down 10 feet or more. And then we reached out to feather edges where the drawdown impact, it was either shown to be or interpreted to go to null. You know, the impact of the test did not reach those locations. So one thing that was interesting and in fact reassuring when we think about recharge is that the drawdown that was monitored in domestic wells was equal in wells that we knew or learned were rock wells versus those that we believe, based on depth, are gravel wells, suggesting that there's a fair amount of communication between fractured rock and sand and gravel, which is beneficial when we start thinking about recharge. It means both formations can allow water to move through. So that's good. A three-day test is not a 10-week shutdown period, but what we collected in all the wells with black dots, plus all of our monitoring wells, were very detailed records of drawdown. And when we analyzed those using methods that all trained hydrogeologists would understand, Jim Gary reviewed the data from DEC. Paul Rubin, who I know looked at this, looked at these kinds of evaluations. We all looked at them. What we can do is we can project what that drawdown would look like after 10 weeks of drawdown at 400 gallons a minute. And that's as far as we needed to project, because the DEP has told us that their shutdowns would be 10 weeks or less. And so the purpose and the assignment here was to identify a source that can get you through 10 weeks and then recover as I described to you. So not surprisingly, when one pumps longer, you would expect drawdown to increase. And so the zero projection extends a little further north, a little further south, a little further east and west. The projections for each of the individual wells are posted here. And this is what allowed us to interpret where 10 feet of drawdown would stop at the end of 10 weeks of pumping 400 gallons a minute. And even at the end of 10 weeks of pumping, our two primary wells were barely predicted to hit 100 feet of drawdown, which sounds like a lot, but having put in a lot of wells, I'm actually pleased, because it's a lot of water. And the other thing that I can tell you that I didn't write in the notes here, one of the things that we're always careful about when we design a well field is that we don't want to introduce air into deep isolated aquifer sections. And that amount of drawdown did not draw water down to the top, below the bottom of the clay. It was still, the water level was still within the clay with those projections, and that gravel bed that would be providing the water would remain saturated through a 10-week of use at this rate, which contributes to confidence that it would remain sort of untouched and could benefit from recharge right after the shutdown period was ended. So this amount of drawdown in these wells, for some wells, honestly wouldn't be a problem. Anybody who has a well that's 100, 200 feet deep, having the static water level when you're not running your pump come to rest at 40 feet or 50 feet lower than it currently does, as long as there's plenty of water over your pump and you have water in the well, wouldn't affect the yield. But we also know that there are some wells in the neighborhood that are shallower, and so it has made prudent sense to propose a water district for the area of greatest influence. And so you know what that is, but let me show you how that looks here. I've moved it to the right, and Dave and I chose different ways of orienting the north arrow, but there's north, and there's north, and my purpose in putting it crooked on this slide was so that you could see that the river is approximately lined up on the two figures. And what this shows is that the proposed water district, wrapping around the cemetery where people don't need much water, picks up in here and comes down the rail trail and comes down south of Cedar and cuts in and basically assures, as a seeker, an appropriate mitigation and a source of water, so that there would be reliable flow and less concern during these 10-week shutdown periods. So those are my slides. And many of you know much of this material. What I've been receiving through many forms of communication are the questions and some questions that have come up. And rather than try to put lots of text on slides, if you'll excuse me, what I've done is I've just sort of addressed those, and I'm just going to go through them. And a copy of my notes, I believe Jeff is going to make available on the website tomorrow or tonight or something like that.
And I'm sorry to interrupt real quick. Everything that we're presenting here tonight, we will have up on the web within the next couple of days. Might even get it up tomorrow, including the material that Russell's going to go through right now. All these slides we'll have up on the website, hopefully tomorrow. If not, I'll get them on Monday. But everything you're seeing tonight, we will have up.
So basically, as I've been receiving and being asked internally to respond to and think about questions to make sure that we're on the right course and that at least from the hydrogeologic perspective, the right recommendations are being offered, kind of boiled down to about seven questions. I'm just going to go through them. Reliability of 400 gallons a minute for 10 weeks. In some ways, I've just walked you through that analysis, but just by way of reminder, New York State DEC's hydrogeologist Jim Gary and hydrogeologist Paul Rubin, as some of you know, and Chazen, all agree that 400 gallons a minute for 10 weeks appears achievable from this source at 101.0. To be prudent, and I should be clear about this, the project team nonetheless intends to use all other shutdown sources ahead of 101.0. So the greatest likelihood is that it won't be used at 400 gallons a minute. In other words, at least for the first shutdown period particularly, this source would be last on, first off, just because it's prudent to think about it that way since it's being asked to produce a lot. So that is, and because we recognize, and because we went into this seeking to ask this source to produce more than its probable long-term sustained pumping rate. So question two is, what's the long-term pumping rate? And the answer is, we don't know. It has not been confirmed. It was not the purpose of the test to try to attempt to identify. The rate of 275 that was maintained for about 25 hours at the end of the longer test at 400 was an observation period, because there were people asking me, what do you think it can do? And I said, well, the easiest thing to do is flip off one of the wells for 24 hours and let's watch it. And what we saw was encouraging. We saw the rates of drawdown basically flatline. We did not run it long enough to confirm that. We did not run it long enough for it to be a test that one could go to the health department and the DEC and request permission for. But it was a clue. And it was a clue that for the price of running one well for an additional 25 hours is a contribution to a future discussion, which is not being resolved today. And I hope you understand that nobody's representing that it is being resolved today or on the basis of these data. What we do know is that some 80-some people are currently using their wells. Within this service, proposed service area, and that I don't think we would have any difficulty representing to Health Department and DEC that sort of that equivalent quantity of water could be withdrawn from the single location as opposed to from 80 some individual wells. So kind of on a 1-for-1 gallon basis. For one thing, we've just been through a 400 gallon a minute test, so if something like 15 to 20 gallons a minute is asked of this well, they think we can feel fairly confident in that. And that's about the only confident number that we know at a level that can be defended to a regulatory agency. And I'll just remind you guys, as I reminded my guys and many people during this test, Chazen doesn't issue well withdrawal permits. David Clouser doesn't issue well withdrawal permits. We file applications. And the Health Department approves, and the New York State DEC approves. And it's why we've worked closely with them, and we have provisional comfort levels with them on the short-term arrangement. But we have not asked them or represented to them that 275 is a long-term sustainable rate. Groundwater quality from 101 Plains Road. Certainly the water quality samples collected at the end of our test was excellent. We had one well that didn't completely clear up its turbidity before we started the test, so that well would probably be replaced with a different well, but coming from the same source area. Certainly the well water from production well one was superb, required only disinfection. And that's honestly a health department requirement. We could shock the well, probably serve the water. But that's not the way the health department does it these days. Water quality could shift over a 10-week, 400-gallon-a-minute shutdown period. If it did, it would move in the direction of perhaps a blend of the water quality identified at the end of 3 days and a blend or an average of the water quality in the nearby formations, which means the well water quality data collected, with thanks to many of you, from the domestic wells is a good indicator of what the blend could move towards. And what's pretty reassuring from that is that when you look at the average water quality data for two rounds of water level, water quality data in the domestic wells, the only thing that might come close to exceeding a water quality standard would be iron, which if necessary is not a, could be an emergency temporary add. But the average iron was only over standards in one of two rounds of sampling and only slightly, so if it was a blend, the greater likelihood is that there will be no quality exceedances even if there's a shift over the 10-week period. This is also a reason, though, to move towards the process of last on, first off. If we can use Plains Road or the 101 Plains Road source after reservoir use and after PLESA and after and after water conservation measures, and the use is therefore less than 400 gallons a minute, there's you also reduce the concerns about shifts. And certainly, if in the future and when in the future, just for the purposes of the water district users, pumping at a lower pumping rate would move closer to the really nice quality water that the test revealed right now. Question five. Drawdown. How confident are we in the drawdown at the end of 10 weeks, 400 gallon minute pumping? The figure that I showed you is based on data and projections from a lot of wells that were monitored. It wasn't just one well or two wells. It was a lot of wells, and all the ones that I showed you that have the black dots, they were all used for those projections, and then. For all of the other wells where we had manual data, we did a quick check on all of them to confirm that none of them were doing something starkly different from those that have a high level of data resolution with data loggers. So you know, we have 50 some wells that were all pointing in the same direction. And that was reassuring to me. So an understanding of the 10-week projections was based on that kind of analysis, and once again has been looked at by other hydrogeologists, and I think we're all feeling that the projections make sense. To be a little bit conservative, the water district boundaries were extended, particularly to the south, a little bit further than the projections might have strictly suggested. There's no reason to provide water when drawdown of just, you know, these impacts that are, you know, 5, 10, 7 feet, as long as the well has enough saturated thickness, you know, don't need to provide a water district, or don't need to provide mitigation, honestly, but to be conservative and extend that a little bit further was just a way of saying, okay, we got a lot of consistency in the projections, but we're going to be a little conservative in the extent of the district boundaries. Let's see. The impacts. Okay, so impacts from 400 gallons a minute for 10 weeks. You know, are we harming the aquifer? Are we making it? Are we damaging it in some fashion? It's a question that has been forwarded to me. Aquifer pumping can reduce aquifer capacity and quality, particularly if air is allowed to repeatedly enter formerly isolated aquifer zones. The reason that happens is that basically you emit air, you allow oxidation, and you can mineralize what's down there, and then you start to clog pores. You can also weaken the structural, you know, the water is not there sort of holding up the formation. Our 10-week projection values suggest and show that the water level won't fall below the top of the clay. And I guess I would point to the empirical evidence that certainly after our pumping test, the water levels filled right back up. So I think we're pretty confident that we're not harming the aquifer, we're not changing the recharge areas, we're not changing the amount of rain that falls in the Hudson Valley, we're certainly not changing rock formations or sediment formations, and we're treating the formation responsibly. So I think we're feeling pretty good that we're not harming the aquifer. It will retain its ability to be pumped hard during a series of 10-week shutdown periods, and in between, respond to precipitation and recharge, and then be itself as an aquifer formation between those periods. Last question. 2014 weather conditions. 2014 started kind of average, and then went into dry period after our test was done. But it's, you know, the fair point that people have made is, well, you didn't run this test during a drought, therefore you didn't test its worst case condition or its worst case scenario. And this question was put to us also by the U.S. and now it's just the New York State DEC hydrogeologist, and our response was pretty simple. New York City DEP does not plan to shut down their tunnels or their systems or their reservoirs in the middle of the drought. And so what we have is a fairly clear statement from them is that the 10-week shutdown period wouldn't happen in the middle of the drought. And therefore, it wasn't necessary for us to run our tests during a worst-case drought condition because those are not the conditions under which the 10-week shutdown would take place. So there was no need to evaluate 101 Plains Road under drought or particularly dry summer conditions. So that information has been provided to the DEC in writing, and on that basis, they were comfortable with the test. So you're not just hearing it here. It's been stated by DEP. It's been received, and they made a part of the discussion with the DEC. So those were some of the categories of questions that were at least fed to me. And I'm going to turn the floor back over to Dave to run through some more of the connection, more distribution kind of topics, and then we're here for further discussion.
I'm a little concerned to stand up at this point with all the work that Jeff did on trying to get the lights.
You can hold it up. You can stand up and hold it if you want. Either one.
It's okay. As I had said before, there was the 40 questions, and I believe this is already on the website. I hope many have looked at this. These were questions that have been collected for the last several months, and we tried to get some answers on that. We know there's more questions that are out there, and we're trying to provide some information to answer those.
Can you speak up, please?
We can't hear you, thank you. No, you use the
microphone. I may have to stand up. Is this better?
Better
if
I stood up.
How's this?
Better.
Okay, good. Wanted to go through just very quickly. Again, I want to be able to have plenty of time for questions here, so I'm going to go through this quickly. Expect questions on the end on many of these. One of the pieces I want to talk about just really quickly is the process for establishing a water district. Our office has done it on several. It's a New York State town law regulated process. It's a water district. There's four of them in the town right now. There's three sewer districts. It's a process where the revenue needs to equal the expenses at the end of the year. It's not a profit-making part of the government. We're just trying to cover costs here. So every year, we're looking at what the expenses were, what revenue came in, the rates, the water rates may get adjusted. The town doesn't adjust them very often. In fact, I think the last time they were adjusted, it was because of water rates that were for the purchase of water from the village that we had to take the rates up. Otherwise, it's usually been 5 or 6 years between adjustments. Another point was, must everyone be included in the water district? And the town board supports allowing opt-out of connection. If a person wants to not connect at the time that the water district is formed. There's provisions that the plumbing can be put into the house for a future connection. If you want to be in the water district and connected, the plumbing is put in, it's connected to your plumbing system, get to the cost later, but basically there's no cost to that. There is a provision that you can continue to use your well if you choose to, if you're connected to the water district, but the two sources can't be connected. We have to watch out for contamination, cross-contamination. But people that would like to keep their well to be able to water lawns or whatever they need to do outside is certainly welcome to do that. The improvements being proposed are, of course, the water mains. The water district has the water mains. It'll be in the streets. There'll be service lines that come to the house. There'll be fire hydrants for fire protection. There's a small treatment plant. The treatment plant is not very complex because the only thing that needs to be done is disinfection on this source. The services from the street to the house, again, are going to be reimbursed. There's no cost to that. And then, again, the plumbing inside the house connection is also going to be no cost to the resident. And I'll get in, and on really on the next slide, on who will pay for the improvements, but basically the water district expenses are being reimbursed by the DEP, since this seems to be the optimal solution to being able to have that temporary shutdown, the water sources there. And the water district will make sure that everyone continues to have good clean water. Who will be responsible for its maintenance? As I said before, water districts are formed to the operation and maintenance is the expense part of it. The revenue, of course, is the water rates. The expense of the maintenance is the operation of the plant, the pumping, monitoring for the regulatory standards, distribution, reporting, of course, this testing is often because it's a Department of Health regulated facility, public water supply. Also the billing, the administration, and the billing. Those are all expenses. Again, this would be one more water district of the four that the town already maintains. How long will the construction take? If it's going to be good weather, could be 4 months. Depends on the timing of when we really start. We're hoping to be able to start in the summertime. That means that we really need to get going on the design. Right now we're starting the seeker process. We need to get next into the formation of the water district and then really get the design done. Next slide is, this is just another district boundary map showing who's involved in the district. Next one, please, Wes. This is the water cost to the users. It lists first here what's going to be reimbursed to the town. So all the planning, design, legal, and construction costs for the water system are going to be reimbursed, which includes the cost for the water mains, cost for the fire hydrants, the service lines to each house. The user's fee now is something that's relatively new. The user's fee is going to be, there's a fund of $125,000 that the DEP is going to add to this project to be able to pay water rates for average usage, a home's average usage for, we're predicting, 5 to 6 years. There was also a concern about, some were concerned about chlorine in the water. It's a requirement that there's residual chlorine in the water. It's a very minor amount. Some are not interested in having any chlorine at all, so the DEP is included. Reimbursement for filters, carbon filters, take the chlorine out once it's in your house. Here the water mains are anticipated to be maintained by the village, DPW. This is very recent. This is not something that the village board has voted on, certainly, but it's part of the conversation we're having now. Treatment and pumping would be maintained by the town water district. Water use costs are estimated to be $18 per month for average household usage. That average usage was using some USGS average per capita usage, factoring that times the census figures for an average household of 2.3 children, 2.3 people, sorry, 2.3 children. And that came out to like 210 gallons per day, and that also was factored in that 70% of the usage was in the home, 30% was, again, this is a nationwide survey, 30% was outside usage, and the Northeast really doesn't do much lawn watering, so I don't think that 200 gallons per day is pretty close for an average house, I would expect. And at this point, I think I'd like to go to questions, but is there any of the town or village folks that have anything to add before we open that?
I think I just had a couple things, and I don't know then if Tim had a few pieces. Just actually, if you go back to the slide, there you go. So a couple things that we are still working on. One of them David hit upon, which are the water mains and the maintenance. I know questions have been about maintenance. Another piece we've been talking about, one is everything that's being installed is new material. The first 5 years of it is covered under the contract, so any maintenance, anything in the first 5 years would be covered by the contractor. This also includes the DEP is purchasing two pumps, and the reason being is you always have a backup pump, so if something does go wrong, we would have another pump instantly available to cover that. The other piece we are actually just working on, and we were even working on it as late as today, the water system that we're being asked for on Plains Road. We're being asked for this to provide water to our whole community. We are a backup water system. So as a backup water system, we've been working with the mayor, we've been working with our attorneys, and what we're looking to do is provide a fund that would be in every other water district's bill, and that would create a fund that would be used for the maintenance of the water system. So the water district, proposed water district, would then be supported by a fund that everyone pays into that is benefiting from it beyond just the users on Plains Road, which is the water district. So this is being created so everyone has water, where we are right now has water because of a water system. So all users would then pay in to maintaining the water system. Now it also would not just benefit this water system, it would also benefit the village, where they also will be doing some maintenance and improvements up on the dams and the reservoir system. So not only will this fund cover improving and maintaining anything that could possibly happen down on Plains Road, but this would also maintain and ensure that the reservoirs that we have up on Mountain Rest Road are also maintained and kept whole, and that no one is all of a sudden stuck with a bill for something they didn't ask for or we really don't need right away. So that was a big piece we are working on. Also, the water use cost estimated, as Dave said, we're kind of struggling with it. We took it on the higher side. And again, the reason being is we're using national averages. That number could be up a little if you have many users, and it could be down a little bit if you don't have as many users in your home. Another question was asked, I know Dave gave a little bit of an engineering speak there. There's been some questions about the disturbance of the road or the trees along the road. In general, any of you that are in contracting, you don't dig in the trees. It's a lot easier if you dig where the trees aren't. So it would absolutely be disturbing the roadway, not the trees. You tend to disturb one side of the road so you can maintain a traffic pattern on the road. And then the same is true for the home. Part of the design phase, when we get up to the design phase, part of the design phase will be having the contractor that is setting up the design phase meet with each homeowner, and you will decide where you want the line run. If you want the line to go around some trees, shrubbery, or where you want it into your home, that will be up to you. And the same is true for the opt-out. If during the opt-out period, if you do want to opt out, you know, we'll have the option of having the contractor, while they're there, run a copper line up to your basement, again, all at the cost of the DEP, and it will just sit there. And then should you decide later on you want to hook up, you will have it available to you. We will come, we put in a meter, because the meter is at the cost of the water district or the town, and we would then hook you up to the system. Also includes your well. If anyone wants to use your well, David mentioned the outside use. If you want to continue to use your well, we will be unhooking just the plumbing to hook the water system into your home. If you want to hook your well into an outside system, you're welcome to do that with a contractor. That would be up to each homeowner, but you're welcome to hook that up too, and that would actually be at your expense, but when the plumber is there, you can discuss that with them. I know those are some of the questions I've been asked very recently, and I don't know if Tim had anything he wanted to add.
Sure, I can. Is this?
Yeah, or if you want to stand up, Tim, or you want to rest on.
I think it's alone. Well, I can add a little bit, in particular, related to the bullet point where it says water mains are anticipated to be maintained by the village DPW. That's something that we've begun to explore with our village attorney.
We think using the village DPW, if there were instances where for the length of the intermunicipal agreement between the town and the village, if there were maintenance issues, the clearest path may be just to have the village DPW responsible for dealing with the water lines that are actually on the road, because we have a DPW staff that's already familiar with dealing with those issues in the village. So we're trying to investigate how that could be done, and then what that arrangement would look like in terms of an agreement between the town and the village. And it may be just as simple as there's an arrangement where if there is a situation where, again, we're not anticipating regular maintenance issues, because A, this project, the water lines would be guaranteed for 5 years by the contractor, and B, these will be new lines, so we're not anticipating near-term problems or intermediate-term problems. But again, this arrangement would be for the length of the IMA, the intermunicipal agreement, and it could just be as simple as the village DPW being allowed to access with an ongoing agreement with the town to go ahead and perform maintenance and repairs if a situation like that ever arose.
And actually, I just add to that, since you brought up the IMA, as everyone knows, we signed an IMA with the town, with the village. And one thing we're also exploring, because there have been questions from many of you also about what the plans are for the water. Dave mentioned it in his, again, his engineering report there along with Russell. The high end of it was the 300 gallons. We are anticipating at getting the well certified by the Department of Health and the DEC at 20 gallons per minute. So that would feed all of our homes. What we are looking at right now is now extending the intermunicipal agreement from its current term we have signed to extend it out to 50 years, and then extend it with 5-10 year renewal options on it. So what that would do is that would guarantee the lifespan of everyone here, and I'm not calling anyone here old, so please don't take it the wrong way, but it would certainly take care of anyone who is in this room, and then also even possibly the next generation. So we would have a 100-year guarantee that this water would only be used during shutdowns with the DEP. We do have a couple scheduled. It's very possible it is an old system. They may want to be doing work again in 30 years from now. But what it would do is it would create a contract between the town and the village that it would never exceed the 20 gallons per minute. So the town would never, and future town boards, would never have the ability to go forward and
make it into a position where they could be selling the water or growing the districts out. As most of you know, too, the district is, this water district is defined, without going back to the map, where I believe the map is here, there is not a lot of growth potential left in the area. One of the other benefits of this is one of the largest areas of growth potential is actually where the well fields are. If we take control of that piece of property, the growth potential of that piece of property comes in somewhere around zero. Because it would be, sorry Dave, but that's, yeah, that would be it, yeah. We're not building, the town's not going to be building houses down there, it ain't happening. So we have no plans for that, except for it to be a well field. There is, it would be part of the next phase we're going into. Last night we made the announcement, we had a special meeting last night. We did get $1.574 million from the DEP. And that money is to reimburse us for the work that we've done since January 23rd. And it's for the next stage of the work, which is designing the engineering to start the engineering. And that would also include investigating on the well field both here on Plains Road and also the well field on the land now known as, or were known as, the Plesser property. So again, to help protect everyone here, there are a couple pieces we're looking at. Does anyone else have anything else? Does our attorney or anyone, or any of our attorneys here, have anything want to add? If anyone would like to ask questions, if you're comfortable standing up, you can just stand up and ask a question, or if you want, I'll pull the lectern out, and you're welcome to come up and ask any questions.
Can I turn the light on?
You can turn the light on, Lauren, yes, you don't mind.
People, I'm
going to turn themselves
before they speak,
please. Can people identify themselves? We've had a request from our reporter, if people could identify themselves when they come up and speak, and for the record.
I think it might be on, it's just long.
Yeah. No one has any questions? We were that good?
I have a question.
There you go, I knew someone would.
Okay, I'm Dale Monteleone. So I just was a little confused by some of the things that you were saying earlier about the wells that were close and the small amount that dropped. Personally, my well was going down 20 feet a day, and I was across the street from the pumping station, which according to your data, I wasn't supposed to be affected that way. So there's some, I'm a little confused about that. And you said if it was good weather, it would be maybe 4 months. What is the outside of that if it's not good weather?
So let me.
So they're not going to be answered now. I'm just
have
to ask them.
No, Dale. I'd be happy. I'm just making sure I understand questions. I think, not sure what the question was in the first. You certainly are one of the nearest homes.
The first one really was more. It's part of my concern about the way this whole thing has gone. You know, I keep hearing information that just doesn't jive, and being told things that I'm going, wait a minute, that's not the truth. And another part was where you said that there was no problem except for extra iron in the private wells of the homeowners. And we had coliform, E. coli, and lead. Like, how does, I don't get it. You know, that was, they're not equal. And I don't know where the distortion is. And it bothers me. And it leads me to not trust what people are saying. So that I'm not comfortable with anything, because all along there seems to have been incongruous. I guess this is probably the best word I can find, because I'm really nervous and my brain just stopped working.
So there are a couple different things, and I'm sorry if it has not seemed as clear or direct as you would wish. You, for example, have one of the deeper wells that's right across the street from 101 Plains Road. You certainly were, and the drawdown plots showed, you were not somebody who had just 20 feet of drawdown. You had significantly more than that.
10 feet a day, and it wasn't stopping. That was 60 feet and that well went down.
Well,
and where was it going to end? Which I guess is why you're giving us a water district, because you've clearly decided that you're going to destroy our
water. What happens during any pumping test is that the water level falls quickly at the beginning and then moves towards stabilization. So your water level did fall quickly in the first 2 days, and by the third day was falling much less quickly. And when we put that on a projected plot, that is what suggested where it would have stopped at 10 weeks. And so that's in the figures that are in the report. Your final total drawdown was in the report. It certainly did. In fact, everybody's well water levels fell quickly in the first day and a half. So did the test well. So falling quickly at the beginning seems worrisome if you're not used to being around pumping tests. So I'm sorry if that hasn't been explained. And that,
no, it's just that you said one number when you were just speaking, and my well actually had a different number. So
yeah, I don't remember what I said.
I don't remember exactly what it was either. I think it was like 10 feet, or it was definitely not as much as 20 feet, but I didn't write it down, and I have no memory of that. I don't remember what it was.
Yeah, I remember talking about 10 feet when we're getting out to the outer areas. You're close in. You're close in, and certainly the amount of drawdown and the rate of drawdown at the beginning was faster and more than what was experienced further out. So I hope that feels honest or clear. So the other piece has to do with quality. As you know, and as the report documents, there's a lot of data about the water quality in the wells, and there are individual wells, and there are the averages. And what would likely move over time and potentially blend with the water quality that it was experienced and sampled at 101 wouldn't be the worst sample in any individual well in Plains Road, it would be more like the average. And so I think
still,
I was...
Still, there was coliform, E. coli, and lead, and all you mentioned was iron. Just saying.
Yeah, and just responding, what I said is that the one compound that in the averages was overstanding
okay,
was
I
iron.
I just wanted on record that there was E. coli, coliform, and lead also. It just makes it sound so innocent the way that the averages bring it down to lead when, iron, but there were people with children in their homes who had lead in their water and couldn't use their water for a very long time. Anyway, so let's go back to the construction. If it's a good weather, we'll have 4 months. And does that include the construction of all the that they'll be bringing into our homes, or how long will that take?
That 4 months, good weather, should include the entire water district, the lawns restored, everything.
Okay. And then the other question I have is for the town. What could your plan be? I know at some point you were talking about putting a park there.
We have, right now, as we answered in that question and answer, right now the only plan we have is to get access to the water wells. We still have not defined whether we will have access to all the land or whether we will have access to just the well heads. Regardless of either one, we have no plans of any development of that property at all.
And will the community be involved if you start to make a plan?
Absolutely.
Thanks. That's all my questions.
Because just saying it would take community funds to do anything there. So we would have to, it would take money we don't have. So if you took the example of this year, we're going into next year's budget right now to stay within the tax cap, we're basically going to be a, you look great, you're smiling great, don't worry, you look fine. You're looking at budgets right now, and we do not know when this is going to end. The town budget will be increased to zero.
Right,
so
I was here last night.
So as you go forward, anything that we possibly want to do with that land would embody public funds, and I don't picture us. I think with Field of Dreams and Clearwater Park, we have our hands filled right now for many years.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Jim Dodd, Plains Road South, Dodd Farm. Quiet on my end.
The longest resident on Plains Road.
Who said that, Carla?
I did. No, the second longest resident in Sacred Longest.
Okay, I'll take it. I'll take it. You're right.
I didn't say oldest.
The quality of water, David, you described the quality of water as very good. What does that mean? How much sulfur do we have? I have a lot of it. How much iron do we have? Can you break it down?
Without using engineering terms, can you just use a description?
Just off the top of your head.
Off the top of my head, the iron was certainly not up to the standards. There was no sulfur. The only thing it had, I believe, was coliform, and the amount of opening the well to testing, that certainly can be understood as we were testing it. It was really good water. I could go through all the parameters. There's 150 parameters there. We tested for everything, just like we have to do to be able to get the Department of Health permit. It was really a pristine source.
And how far, what was the depth?
Well, give you a little idea. The ground elevation down where the wellhead is about 30 plus feet below Plains Road elevation, where the neighborhood is. There's about 100 feet of clay, and then there's total down to the bedrock is 185 feet, as I remember. So altogether, we're talking about 50 feet of really good gravel, but it's covered with this. It's 10 to the minus 8th clay, which is just ceramic grade, basically. It's really, I'm sure you know what clay is with your farm.
Well, yeah, all of Plains Road is clay, but Dave got lucky, you see. I hit rock at 70 feet in my place. Anyway, thank you.
You're welcome, Jim.
Okay, Marvin Birnbaum, Locust Lane. I have what I hope are four short questions. First off, does the data support use of the 101 Plains Road without a water district?
Writing down. Give me your next question.
I'll take one order.
Well, and this sort of goes along with that, so that's fair. There are approximately 80 wells in the area. How many of the wells would not need mitigation if you used 101 Plains Road without a water district? And you could give me an approximation.
Yeah, it would have to be an approximation, and it gets at some of the issues that Dale mentioned. Because the wells that are nearer to 101 Plains Road did experience during the pumping test and will experience greater influence than the wells that are further. Bedrock wells that are 100.5 or greater feet deep, and many are both farther out and closer in, many of them might be able to get through the whole shutdown period without losing capacity at all. The shallower ones that I'm familiar with might be in the order of 20, something like that. So there's a preliminary
there thought. There are 20 shallow wells?
Yeah.
Okay.
So if there were no water district, it would be possible to do some of the alternative mitigation measures on those 20 wells that are in that 40 or so question Q&A that you have posted. I believe you suggested well deepening or water trucks or other means.
Yeah, I think there's been some discussion of mitigation, monitoring mitigation kind of approach. And those would be part of the thought processes. And actually, you're getting out of hydrogeology for me, but as I understand it, that's the answer.
Dave, do you have something to say on that?
Just that SEACR requires that some form of mitigation be provided so there's no adverse impact. And the water district is certainly the most foolproof method to do that.
Have you prepared a specific list of wells that need mitigation versus not needing mitigation? Or is that only something you would look at in the event that the water district idea was rejected?
I can only answer the first part of that question. We have not refined that list because the only way to do it in a way that would give me a comfort level as a hydrogeologist would probably involve sounding all the wells. And to do that involves asking every resident to allow a pump pull rig on their site and pull the pump and then sound the well and then put the pump back. And certainly that isn't something we've asked for or burdened people with. As a result of the work we've done, and as a result of some homeowners having records of their wells, we have some of that information, but we certainly don't have enough.
And this was not discussed today, and maybe our political leaders can enlighten me. The need for a referendum on the water district, is there a legal requirement that there be a referendum?
Or to any one of our attorneys?
When we talk about the formation of a district, there are two ways to do it. One is if a petition is put forward by the residents within the district, and there is a certain requirement for the number of people and who would have to sign that petition. If a petition is properly signed by the requisite number of people who want the district, that petition then comes to the town board. One of the things the town board has to look at then is the plan for this district and essentially whether or not the properties that are outlined in the district are benefited by the formation of the district. Benefit in that sense means that the pipe in the ground runs past the lot, runs past the home, so that it can be hooked up. Not supposed to create districts where the people don't have a chance to hook up. They can't get to the pipe. Okay. If a petition comes in and if the board finds everything that it is supposed to do and forms the district, there is no referendum. There is no vote to confirm that. The other way to form a district is that the town essentially on its own motion determines that it would be in the best interest of a particular area if we form a district. If the board goes forward with that on its own motion, the people within that district have the ability to bring a proper petition and move that determination to a vote, a permissive referendum, okay? If the vote passes, the district can be formed. If the vote doesn't pass, then the district doesn't get formed. But those are the Reader's Digest version of the two ways to do it. In the petition method, there is no permissive or mandatory referendum or vote, because the vote essentially has been taken in the taking of the petition. In the other aspect, there is a potential for a vote.
Okay. It seems that there's been a great deal of effort to provide two separate opt-out options to the district. So it seems to me that the people who are opposed to having a water district get two bites at the apple. On one global level, they can attempt to stop the district by winning a referendum, but even if they lose, they still have the ability to individually opt out. Whereas the people who are in favor of the district only get one shot. If the district doesn't get passed and 101 Plains Road gets pumped, they essentially have no choice about what mitigation is going to be provided. Is that correct?
I'm not sure.
Was it a fair question?
Okay, yeah, I'm not sure I understand the question.
Otherwise, if the well is going to be used, the mitigation choices then would be, correct me if I'm wrong here, what you're saying is, should there not be a formation of a benefiting district, benefiting both all the residents and all the benefits of a water district, and us having a backup water supply, not only for shutdowns, but should other emergencies happen, we now have a backup water supply forever, so it's a stable water supply. So the next piece would be then, if we do not create the water district and the 101 Plains is used, the mitigation that would be used on the affected wells would be where Russell was keying in on. It may involve sounding of wells, it would involve bringing in portable bladders, it would involve, what else could it possibly involve? That would be, it would be using mitigation methods that are not attractive methods at all. And they would be temporary methods only. So during each shutdown period, there would be many challenges to meeting the demands of the water of those around. The best mitigation and the one that benefits this community the most is to put in a water district, because then everyone gets the advantages of having the water source, and then we have the advantage of not only having a backup water source during known shutdowns, but should a catastrophe happen, we would then also have a backup water supply system.
I'll try to clarify what I was asking, because it's clear that you answered something that I wasn't asking, which meant I messed up the question.
Sorry.
So, essentially, the town and the village, based on the work that your engineers have done, have decided that 101 Plains Road is the best source for all those benefits you just outlined. Okay. The affected residents, more or less the 80 homes in the proposed water districts, now have a choice. Now, I believe many of my neighbors are under the impression or the hope that if we could somehow prevent a water district being established, that the pumping of 101 Plains Road will go away. And I'm trying to really get at the bottom line on that, because if 101 Plains Road is going to happen, whether we have a water district or not, there'll be consequences that are more severe if we reject the water district. Obviously, accepting the water district gives us the bulletproof solution, but there are many people in the neighborhood who are against having a water district. So I'm just trying to understand. If the people who are against the water district are successful in stopping the water district, does that mean this pump site is not going to happen and you're not going to run a line out the few hundred yards of the well bank? That's pretty much it.
Now I understand the question.
Okay.
Okay. So you want to answer it?
No. Because, well, I don't have the answer for it, nor do I think that that's for legal.
So the
to
answer,
chime in on.
So
somebody else needs to answer the question. If there is no district, is this water source going to be used anyway?
Yeah.
That's your question.
Potentially, yes. This could still be a water source, because under, I believe Dave just said it, under CEQA, the requirements is that a project still goes forward as long as mitigation is provided. So there are different forms of mitigation. Now that up to and includes if the current landowner of that property also wants to, the landowner now has
a well system with a known high capacity short term and can certainly now go and test it for wells and develop homes there, which would also draw it down. It's R1 zoning there. There is more than room. So I can't sit here and tell you what the property owner's plans are. We have not asked, and we aren't going to ask. And I can't tell you from the final engineering, and I don't believe any of our engineers here working for the DEP have a final answer too. We're not there yet, but 101 Plains Road will certainly be, I expect to be reading about it still, even if the water district does not go through, to be a water source and what the other mitigation efforts will be. And those mitigation efforts will all fall under the requirements of the State Environmental Quality Review Act.
Thank you very much.
While you were asking the legal question, I was getting out the map and refreshing my memory. My guess is somewhere between 20 and 30 homes would need mitigation.
Can you say that louder? Say that again.
My earlier number was 20, and as I had a chance to look at the map while we were talking on other subjects, I came closer to somewhere between 20 and 30.
I'm saying 20 or 30 homes would be adversely affected if the well was pumped without a water district.
The question I received was which might need well deepening or other mitigation in advance, and that number may be between 20 and 30. Thanks.
Hello, I'm Chris Hart, 133 Plains Road. A few questions. One of them is I see where it says that the homeowner would be granted up to 6,000 gallons a month. I need an explanation for that. I certainly use well over 6,000 gallons a month to run my business. I also went to the EPA's website today and found, I put up the indoor water use in the United States, and it says that an average family of four uses 12,000 gallons of water a month, according to the EPA's statistics. According to another US statistic, a family of four would use 9,000 gallons a month. So, you know, when it says we can use up to 6,000 gallons a month, I know personally with my business I use well over 6,000 gallons a month, and it's never been an issue for me for 26 years having my own well.
If you have your business, you're using your own well, and you could continue to use your well for your business.
I have never had my pump go down on me, except for a lightning strike a few years ago. But my well has been, I've never been done dry, and I'm using well over 6,000 gallons a month. So would I be charged if I go over that 6,000 gallons a month, even though everybody else is getting it because they're staying under? But this was, currently I'm using my own well and I'm not having an issue.
If I were you, I would continue to use your well for your business, but for your home, I would be on public water. Let me give you a better answer to your question here. It's actually a question that was asked. What is the average home water usage per month as it relates to the next question, which is another question behind this? The answer was the U.S. Geological Survey studies show that the average water use in the U.S. per capita per day is 80 to 100 gallons, that's per person per day, with 70% of that amount used in the home and 30% used elsewhere, irrigation or whatever, outside the home. For an average household per census figure, I think I mentioned this earlier, there's 2.3 persons per household. This would be equivalent to 184 to 230 gallons per household per day, or an average of 6,210 gallons per month. Understanding that few households water their lawn in our community and in the Northeast in general, we believe that 2,000 gallons per month is a reasonable average household usage rate. Now, if you have four kids and two of them are still in diapers, and
I have over 2 million kids, and they're called bees.
They're called bees. Yes, I remember you have bees, which is cool.
I would suggest for the business that you certainly continue to use your well for your
business.
What if
my well goes dry? What happens then?
I'm
understanding. So use the water district coming to my house for my personal household use. but then use my well for my business. But if my well goes dry because of this 101 pump, what do I do?
Can you tell me, Chris, where you live here?
133.
He's about where the 10 isobar is, about...
Yeah.
He's between the 10 and 20 isobar.
If you're 133, you might be in the location where...
Well, my well's very deep as well.
Precisely.
Do you know how deep it is, Chris? 175? 275. So this is predicting a drawdown of 10 feet at that location, is that right?
He's between the ISO bars and
certainly far enough that you're going
to
be okay.
But that's an excellent question for people who live much closer. I'm sorry, but that's important for all of Plains Road to know.
Right.
Because he's lucky that he's further down. I'm right across the street pretty much. So what happens if we decide to use our well water for other things to decrease the cost of our, because I have a bunch of kids, well, not a bunch of kids, but I have kids and animals. I'm not 2.3 people in my house. So what happens if we try to use our well when that goes dry? Yeah, are we going to be infected? But I'm definitely, my well's going to go. So Chris's question is really relevant to all of us.
It does depend on the well construction, and it's why the water district is being proposed, because during the 10-week shutdown periods, the wells are all likely to experience the amount of drawdown that the projections suggest. And if you are one of the people who have shallower wells, that's precisely why the mitigation is being offered.
And I think Jim can help us out here too, because he oversees lots of things. So that we do know having known users in our community in the village.
One thing that I've looked at recently are how many gallons college properties are using per bedroom. And our engineers, when they look at these college properties, they spec it as if they assume 150 gallons per bedroom will be used per day. It's not even anywhere close to that. I've actually looked at the bills of very large college properties. And if you look at the number of bedrooms, these college students are using 60 gallons per day. It's well below what's specced out from the engineers. Maybe the kids aren't taking as many showers as we anticipate, but actual usage is significantly less.
Okay. That was question number one. Question number two is, when you mentioned a carbon system for water, i.e. to take the chlorine out, is that a carbon system that they're willing to put onto the sink so that the water that we cook with and drink is non-chlorinated, or a carbon system that we put with the entire house?
All house.
That's what we're expecting to put in. It comes right in, right after the meters, basically. You change the cartridge.
Okay, and that will remove all the chlorine? And also, when you were saying earlier, the chlorine levels, I used to, many years ago, I sold water filtration devices, actually, the last public meeting that we had here, I had gone and tested the village water as a public site and found the level to be almost, you know, more than triple the amount of chlorine in the water that is legally allowable in the municipal swimming pool. I'm using a faucet, using the orthotolidine, the test. Every time I ever did it, I sold a lot of water filters, because when I go to somebody's house and turn on their sink and let it run for a long period of time and then do the sample, it was bang above the allowable in the municipal swimming pool. So people are going to be showering in this chlorine and things like that if they don't want a carbon system. And I just found, I found once where the level wasn't that high, but consistently found the level above the level that should be in the municipal pool. So I just find that, I know that you're saying that and that's what it's supposed to be, but who's regulating what's going into the water? Why do I keep on coming up to those levels with my local power line test?
I wish I could answer that with a village system. I don't
know.
Right
now, but you would find it, double the. I just want to make a point of that.
Chris, I can just tell you that metering in on this system is much different, and it's a very defined. It's not 800,000 gallons a day here.
And Chris, I'll also check up on that. Just
check up on it, please.
No, but I will. But I'll just let you know too that I'd be very surprised, and I think Tim would be very disappointed. The cost of chlorine is an associated cost, and I would be shocked if it's
Because I'm actually a certified pool operator, too. Right, well, I'd be very shocked if Tim would allow them to
buy it. Yeah. Public source, turn the water for 5 minutes and do the test, and let me know. But I think you might find it be like almost mad. I do have plans that update an outbuilding of ours to create a honey house, though. It's you know, in our schedule for 3 years from now. Is that something that, I mean, that I would have to tap into that system that's in a different part of my property, and which, you know, I've already talked to the town assessor about, you know, if we get the permits to do the, you know, set up a septic system, set up a water input, you know, was going to come off of my of a secondary well. But now that there's a water district, it would have to come off of that. How would that be affected? That's something we...
This sounds, Chris, it sounds like an accessory use. It's certainly not a residence, so I'm not sure why there'd be any reason for you to have to use public water for something that's, you're saying it's part of your business, right?
Yeah, but, you know, and hopefully my well is good enough to handle it, but I'm just, you know, concerned that my well has been an issue, it's been no issue with me, you know, for the 26 years I've been there, and now all of a sudden I'm dealing with something that I never thought I'd have to deal with, because my well was always fine and still is.
It's 275 feet deep. It's definitely in bedrock, and you have a lot of water column there. The drawdown will be, looks like, very little in your well where you're located.
Well, you did lots of testing on it, too, so you can look that up. I think I'm okay. I just wanted to make these points out. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, I'm Krista Burke, and I'm at 92 Plains Road. And the two previous people who were up here asked two of my questions, so that's two less questions I have to ask. We keep talking about this 10-week period, this 10-week shutdown period of aqueduct. Is it the plan that this will be long-term? I'm just trying to understand that because I've been like out of the loop a little bit. Are we saying that the shutdown is just for 10 weeks? And once we're a water district, are we a water district? Is that a permanent thing, or are we talking about going back and forth between the 10-week shutdown period, and then all of a sudden we're not going to use that anymore, and now we're going to go back to the aqueduct, and like the town is going to go back, the village is going to go back to the aqueduct, and we're going to jump back onto our wells? Is there going to be jumping back and forth, or once we are on and hooked up, we're on and hooked up?
Once you're on and hooked up and you opt in, you would be on and hooked up. I will, without going into, if you want, we've had the both the IMA, which is Intermunicipal Agreement, and the IGA, which is the Intergovernment Agreement. They've been online since we signed them. And in that, it restricts the number of shutdowns and the periods between them. Right now, we are scheduled, Dave can tell me here, we have scheduled...
March 2017.
Thank you. March 2017 will be the first shutdown. They are then not allowed to have another shutdown till...
it's the fall of 2018.
There you go. Fall of 2017, and then there's one more shutdown scheduled, and that would be 2 years after that, and that's all the end. So those are all the shutdowns are in the contract.
So then they're not using our aquifer during the periods where they're up and running again. They're back in the aqueduct, but then now we're paying for our water because we're using filtration. So this is what I'm trying to understand, is that for the 10-week period that somebody else is using our water, we are buying, if we buy into this district, then we're now continually paying for it. They're now off of it again, yet we're still continually paying for it.
Well, actually, no.
And we could go back to the well, technically, because we have the option of jumping back and forth.
If you the cost of running the system for the first, we predict it will be somewhere between 5 and 6 years, will be 100% paid for by the DEP.
Which also means that we're not paying a water bill for those
5 or 6 years?
We
will not be paying any water bill for those 5 or 6 years.
Okay.
During the periods of the shutdown, we will also be selling water to the village. This is not free water to the village. There will be a meter. So when the water goes from 101 Plains into the village, they will be purchasing the water, because we do have associated costs. We have that in the contract also.
Because they're essentially also covering our... They're kind of also covering our payments. Is that what you're saying?
No, our payments would be covered already by the money that I negotiated and the town board approved, the $125,000. That will be covering it. The period that we are selling the water, that money is generated by law,
can only go back into the water district. That now will extend the period of time that we then go beyond $125,000.
So
we would then potentially even extend.
So you could potentially be grandfathered in, is what you're saying. Was this that whole, like?
No, there's no grandfather. In other words, that any money generated during the sale of water during those 10-week shutdown periods goes back into the district, and then that would run the district. So the potential for several more years of no water bills.
Just for our district.
Just for our district. Just for water district. The creation of just for water district 5. You have nothing to pay off. There's no bond to pay off. We're not paying for the pumps. We're not paying for the pipes. We're not paying for anything. So the only costs we have are the ones that Russell discussed, which is you pay for the chemicals, which is just chlorine. You would pay for just the monitoring of it. There's required monitoring, which we don't do on our wells now. That is a schedule where they have to be monitored. All that would be the cost. Those costs then would be the first 5 or 6 years. The DEP has given us a fund dedicated to that. On top of that dedicated fund, each time there is a shutdown, we sell water to the village. The village will be paying us for that water. We've already negotiated the rate. That water then, that extra money goes back to our district. And then that would also then pay the bills. So we will exceed the 5 or 6 year period of not paying any water bills at all, which is you pay now for your water. You pay electricity on your well. 2 out of 3 homes just about in our district have water filtration systems of some type. Some of them are highly robust, some of them are very small. All those bills you now no longer have at all. You're not paying electricity to run a pump. You know, you're not changing out a pump. Chris mentioned his got hit by lightning. You have to pull the pump and put a new pump in there. So all those costs now you won't be realizing.
I had one other question. So, it's just my well completely was drained. So I know for a fact, like I was the first phone call. So my next question is that I don't have that option, what a lot of people are talking about, of being able to pay for that extra hookup for well water to be used to like water things and whatnot. I'm just like worried about the chlorine level. Somebody was talking about that before. And I'm also worried about chlorine with leach fields. There's been mentioning like of that, because we're not also becoming a sewer district, we're just a water district. So I just want to make sure that, you know, 10 years from now, that chlorine is not going to affect my leach field and I'm going to start having a major like sewage problem where I'm going to need to spend $25,000 to do something with my leach field that I don't have.
I can let Dave speak on a little bit more, but two things are, one is the amount of residual chlorine is very, very small. It also gases off very quickly. Also, the majority of our water districts do not have a sewer district with them. They run off of a septic system. So most of our town, and this is true in many places, most of our town water districts are not hooked to sewer and use septic. They have no problems with their septic systems. They do the same maintenance that you and I do, which is pumping them out every few years. No more other, and Dave as an engineer could speak a little bit more to it.
Chris, I couldn't imagine that the chlorine could ever make it past your septic tank. Just by the way the chlorine oxidizes organics, it's never going to make it to the septic field.
I guess it's tough, like wastewater treatment plant operator as an engineer. But what they're saying is when chlorine is in water, it's like carbonated water. When you leak carbonated water out, all the carbon dioxide comes out and the water's flat. Same with chlorine, any chlorine that's in the water system. You leave it out for 24 hours. It ain't there anymore. It all comes to the surface. But he said it gases off, just like leaving a glass of ginger ale out overnight. The next morning, there ain't nothing there. So the impact on you, assuming that you didn't avail yourself of the dechlorinator that they're talking about putting in, even whether you did or didn't do that, the impact on you is that part of you would literally be gone.
So plants as well, like my garden and everything.
You can put it straight from whatever you get directly on your sensitive plants. And
if you notice in the village, you'll see beautiful plants and all that, and they use chlorine all throughout the village. And as far as I know, the village plants grow as well as the town plants. I've not done a study on this. I grew up in the village, and we watered all of our garden with it, and never noticed a difference.
And there was somebody else who wanted me to ask a question. They were just questioning the whole, if we want to have availability of the well as well as, you know, the hookup, the town hookup, why is it that needs to be an extra expense right now when we already get, we get that for free, we get our well usage for free? Again, not my question, that was somebody else's who just didn't want to stand up. There's an extra cost associated with if we want to have the hookup, the line, well, the line is free going into the house, well,
yes,
it will be covered. The other hookup with the well. If you want to be able to use the well to do things like water your plants, like would there be a way around having to pay extra for that hookup?
That is a great question, and I will ask the people that are holding the purse strings on that part, and I will get that answer back to you.
Okay. Thank you.
Good question.
I'd like to clarify the shutdown, and the DEP, I think, has got the most recent information on what the plans are. Yeah, if you would.
And I'm sorry, Dan, but I didn't bring along the shutdown schedule, so I was doing it from the top of my head.
Yeah, I mean, that's all right. The 10-week shutdown, as you all know, now holding the first shutdown October 1st, fall of 17, fall of 18, potentially also fall of 19, fall of 20. So it is the reason we've added the fourth and really the third shutdown are to have backup years hydrologically if it's not a favorable year in the first place. The spring is not what we're holding right now.
I have a related question for the DEP. How long is the village contract with the DEP? Will that be forever that you will be, the Catskill Aqueduct will be supplying water to the village? Forever
and ever. In 20 years, you're not going to say,
oh, tough
luck, we're not doing any more funnel work. Okay, forever, the village gets water from you guys. Okay, thank you.
So are you done?
Did you? Okay. And I'm sorry, no, come on up, Donna. No, but I'm sorry, because again, that's what we were talking about with the contract with a couple of pieces. One is the well will only be certified to a level by the Department of Health and the DEC to feed our district. That's it. The periods that it's shut down, it'll be certified for those 10-week periods just to be at a much higher level than we'll ever be certified at. So that's the other piece, and that's it. So we, and then again, why I mentioned, and we'll be working with Tim, we'll be working with our attorneys to extend our intermunicipal agreement, so we are all guaranteed that we will not exceed that level long beyond our lifetimes. And
all right, I have another question. Will the water from the 101 well be going up to the reservoirs?
No.
And then down, or are we just coming directly either to give the village the extra they need? And otherwise shut down and coming right from 101 down
Pointings
Road.
And we can, and I'm sorry, I'll have Dave answer. That's a little bit of a longer answer. I apologize, Donna. Do you mind? Okay, thank you. It's a little bit of a longer answer, so let Dave answer that.
The connection goes down Plains Road and connects actually at Main Street, where one of the primary distribution water mains of the village is. So that's the connection point. It's right there by the rail trail on Main Street, actually.
Will the 101 well of highest quality be intermixing with the other waters that come down from the reservoir and feed the village of New Paltz?
Or the Plains
or
Road
comes
District.
To us?
You're asking whether the Plains Road District will get water
tainted water. I'm not Plains Road water.
I do want to correct that phrase. The water that the village enjoys that I was raised on and many people here live is not tainted water. I do not want anyone here
so
to
sorry.
Yeah, I do not want anyone here to believe or think there is anything wrong with the water that comes out of the Catskill Aqueduct. It is considered some of the best water in the country. It is an incredibly great water source. Dave's going to give an engineering answer, but I'll give you the quick plain speak answer. No, the way the system is designed is the water cannot intermix. And it has to do with the engineering and the way the wells are designed and the pumps are designed and why we don't need a water tower separate for us. We actually will be using the pressure of the water system to maintain our water, let's say our water, the water coming from Roar's property to provide just the Plains Road.
when the water goes out, it can only go one way. It cannot come back. So there is no intermixing of the water. It only heads one way. And if Dave has a further engineering explanation.
Not sure I can do better than that. We're actually pushing water into the village system, and we're doing it under pressure, and it's metered so it's always going in, it's not coming out.
So there's a check valve in the system to prevent that.
It's a little more complicated than that, but that's a pretty good description. I look at it kind of like the salt line in the Hudson, and we keep pushing against that. It's an analogy, but the water goes into the system, it doesn't come out. The only time that the water would be in the Plains Road area is if there were a fire and there was a hydrant on Plains Road and the supply needed to come in through that system to be able to fight that fire. Otherwise, it's always pushing against the water in the village system. I hope that helps.
I have a point. Oh, Donna Liebman, 118 Plains Road. I have a point of clarification and two questions. First, Russell, with all due respect, you mentioned earlier, you indicated that the homes that were closest to the pump site were adversely affected. But in point of fact, the home at 150 Plains Road, which is way at the south end of the road, had lead in their water. And I just wanted to put that out there. I also have a question for you. And this is with all due respect to the DEP and all scientists who are involved and all that. Since shutting down the aqueduct and attempting to fix it, it's like this is a first-time thing. What happens if the shutdown, out of necessity, extends past 10 years? I mean, I think that's a possibility.
It can't by the contract. It can't, period. And I want the DEP, if they want to comment on it, or any of the attorneys, we have... It can't. They cannot go. Well, you say no, but they can't. We literally control. We control the water. The DEP does not own the water source. We own the water source, and I say we, the town. At week 10, we do not any longer have any responsibility to help the DEP, and they will be providing the water. This is a project for which they have done shutdowns in the past in many other parts. The 10-week period is an absolute guarantee. They will not exceed it, they cannot exceed it, and it will not happen. It's part of the guarantee, it's part of the way this is all written. This is something that they have experienced, and the DEP has done this with their system, not only the Catskill system, with multiple systems.
And the nature of the project as well is fixing valves, we're in there cleaning things. You know, our contract will be set up for a hard 10-week shutdown period. We get the contract provision for the contractor that wins the bid. We have a mini staff managing that contract alone, and we'll be on hourly basis, daily basis, maintaining and monitoring that contract as it proceeds. But we're not doing major work that can't be valved off and shut off and get out of the aqueduct. There'll be bailouts and other ways in our town.
Okay. Thank you for that answer.
But we're going for 10 weeks.
Okay. Thank you for that answer. And my next question is for government officials. Last night at the meeting that was held here, one of the items on the agenda was that the town applied, I think is the right word, to become the lead agency in this project, and there's a 30-day period before. That's correct, right? It's 30-day period before you actually are declared the lead agency. So there you got that. At the end of the 30-day period, when you are the lead agency, do you intend to pursue SECR?
Have to.
Yes.
You have to. It's not, it's, you have to. Yes.
Okay, that's the answer I was looking for.
Donna, we will be starting SECR before the 30 days is up.
The 30 days is the, well,
circulation period.
We have the attorneys here, but the 30 days is the period that is required by law, but
right,
you can start prior to the orders here.
Well, because last night, one of the comments that was made by the town supervisor was that during this period of time, during the design phase, it's exempt from SECR. That's what was said at the meeting last night.
It's in the document posted on the website today.
Do you want me to explain that?
Yes, you could, yeah, because
the environmental review will be done on the possibility of building the system, putting the district in place, all of which is a possibility. That's the focus of the environmental review. Doing the kind of design work, planning work that's being done now, that's not required to go through SECR because it's considered gathering information. In fact, the information being gathered is just the information needed to do the environmental review. So the only decision or the action that's being reviewed is the final step of deciding whether or not to put the district in place, whether or not to build in the village improvements on the reservoir, the different construction aspects of this project. So until we get there, so we have studies done, you don't have to review the studies to determine whether to do them. You do the studies so you can do the decision at the end as to whether to do the construction to form the district.
Okay, and just to repeat, what you just said was you intend to pursue SECR, and you said it has to be done.
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much.
Ruth Ellen Wilson, 167 Plains Road, I'm a quarter of a mile back in the woods. I was hoping if I never came out of the woods, this would all go away. And I found myself looking at the questions and answers that were posted. First of all, to the elected officials, it says in question four, in the process of the formation of the town water district, the town board must determine the need for the district and that all property owners within the proposed district would be benefited by the improvements. I think the folks with shallow wells near 101 will be greatly benefited and need to cash in. I think political shenanigans, whatever's going on, I don't understand, but I don't believe I'm going to be benefited. I'm on the other side of the shale ridge, and I would like some clarification I just took another paragraph from four. However, all property owners within the water district would share the ongoing water district maintenance costs since access to public water supply was made available to all through the formation and development of the water district. So just to clarify, I think you tried to answer it, Jeff, but I didn't get it. If the water system comes down, I can opt out, which means you wouldn't run a line through the 50 feet of shale, you're gonna have to dig through to come to my house. But I will still be assessed for the capital reserve fund. So there are really two costs. One is the capital reserve fund, it's gonna come on my tax bill, and the other is water usage. Now if I opt out, I won't have water usage, but I will still have to pay into the capital reserve fund. All properties within the proposed water district would be assessed the capital reserve fund cost to provide for future non-routine maintenance. So after the guarantees are up, should computers go, should pumps go, whatever, the 80 families in this district will be responsible to build up that capital reserve fund, and hopefully it'll be enough. But if it is not, will we be assessed for those costs?
No.
Okay, then how will they be paid for?
You confused a couple different terms there. One is, you used the phrase taxes. None of this is, so to speak, taxes.
Texas would say that it goes across everyone that is a resident, regardless of it's in a water district or not, so it's not a tax.
No, I understand that 80 families, 80 properties are included in this water district in order for you to balance the plus and the minus, the income and the outgo. And I understand that the folks down close to the well really do need it. I'm thinking my well is not going to be affected, and probably not a lot of the wells of my neighbors. And I know you don't like your water, but gee, our water on Cedar Lane is great, and our water on Plains Road is great. And I really, you know, am thinking I am going to have this capital fund charge. What is that?
Well, I answered your question, no. One is, I have never stated I don't like my water. I like my water. Jimmy, I'm neighbors with Jimmy Dunn and with you. Jimmy, do you like your water?
Yeah. I've got three of them. I get 70 gallons a minute. Can't be it.
There we go. And I like my water, too. So I don't know why I don't like my water, because I do like my water.
No, that was a rumor that the line went down past Cedar Lane because you were wanting it.
The first rumor was that Logan doesn't care because he's not in the water district.
Just answer your question. I don't want to hear all that.
And then the next piece came in that Logan must have something in this because he's getting in the water district. You guys tell me you don't want me in water. It doesn't matter.
I don't want to be in the water district, but I have no choice. It says.
Okay, can I answer it, please? Mm-hmm. You asked, do I need to pay? And I answered, no. If you opt out, you will not pay anything. Period.
Ever.
This is what we're doing. It is not a tax issue. You said it would be on your taxes. It is a defeat. No, let me finish. It's not a tax issue. Taxes are what we go across everyone. A water district, by law, is sustained by the users in the water district. What our plan is to do now is to charge everyone that uses water. This is a backup water supply system. Will pay on their water bill an additional fund, a small amount of money. That money will be used to maintain the water district, the backup water district, which would be Water District 5. It'll also be used, part of it will be used by the village to maintain the reservoirs. You opt out, fine, opt out. You will never see a bill for the water district. If you opt in, then you would just see a bill for the actual water usage. That would be it.
But in question four, paragraph 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, it says, however, all property owners within the water district would share the ongoing water district maintenance costs. Since access to public water was made available to all through the formation of the system.
And on August 19, 2015, that was true. And we are now in September 10th, and right now we are investigating and we are working with our attorneys, we are working with the village, we are working with our town attorney and our engineer to have it all covered so there will be no cost to you. So right now the plan is to, so if you opt out, you will not have any cost.
To help clarify the point, and Dave, I'm going to ask you to jump in at some point. That the part that you read that starts on at the bottom of page 3, okay, about the cost and properties being assessed so that things show up on the tax roll. In short, in a typical district where the town pays the cost for the installation of the pipes and the laterals and the machinery and the rest of it. Typically, those costs for capital improvements like that get assessed against the property owners within the district. And this was talking about, in effect, the typical. It goes on at the top of page 4. It says, about in the middle of the paragraph, it says, in this case, the cost of development of the water district is being entirely funded by the DEP, so there will be no water system improvement costs assessed for payment by the property owners.
However,
so you're in a little different situation, okay? However, all property owners within the water district would share the ongoing water district maintenance costs, since access to the public water supply was made available to all through the formation and development of the water district, and maybe somebody wants to speak to...
And I am in the water district.
But somebody else wants to speak to how those costs are going to be raised, not me. Dave Mercy?
Well, one of the things that we talked about a couple different options, one of which is addressed by the pipeline, the village, again, assuming that we can get consent from the village board and the town board, that village employees work in the town, again, it creates workers' comp issues and things like that, as long as we get permission to do it, covering the lines and crossing lines is not going to be a significant issue. But the village can pick that up because we're used to doing it all the time anyway. These are brand new pipes that are going to last for decades. But the issue would be things like pumps. Water pumps classically have, again, I'm talking like I'm an engineer here, but the water pumps very frequently go 10 years, 12 years. We're having an initial pumping system that's set up with 5-year guarantee. There's going to be a second pump system that's already set up. So even in the worst possible case scenario, let's say I'm year five and one day, the major pump goes out, the pump's 400 gallons a minute. First of all, we already have one on the shelf. It's ready to go, and it can last you another 5 years at least. The other thing is that we've been talking about, instead of having an assessment just against District 5, using the, as Jeff was mentioning, using the backup fund for not only the protection, because again, we're talking about the entire backup system, and the backup system will still be in place long after, no matter what happens with DEP. What's happening is the Department of Health is requiring all municipal water systems to have a backup, because again, if something cuts off, it happens.
A backup
water system to serve everybody.
Way to get more.
Yeah, to serve everybody in case of a catastrophic situation. So something really, you know, the really, really bad thing happens to the Catskill Aqueduct. The village would be able to maintain a water system for everybody in the village, you know, the SUNY, everybody in the water district. And so this is getting us to a point where we would like to be anyway, which is to have a complete backup system, regardless of whether it was a shutoff from DEP or not.
Absolutely.
So one of the ways we're going to do and maintain that system is that we have a very small charge, and we'll have at least a minimum of 5 years within which to collect it. So if it becomes district-wide, you have a very, very small charge that we apply against all users. But then set aside, capital expenditures is a very common thing. You build into your normal expenses for running the system, because it's pretty dumb if you run a system and don't plan for the fact that pumps eventually wear out.
So the capital reserve fund that was mentioned in this document is the little extra assessment on top of the water usage.
Correct.
Assessment
that we already know that we're going to have five years to develop.
To build it up.
Correct.
But not just you, all 7,000 users.
Across the village, all water users,
the special water districts, the 400 users we have in the town.
Exactly how that's going to be laid out hasn't been completed yet, but it then provides us with another need, which is again reservoir maintenance and other issues that are going to manifest themselves moving forward in maintaining the emergency backup system, regardless of what happens. So
my next question is for everyone whose wells may be affected by this pumping. If we want to opt out, but we're afraid that our well will be impacted and the DEP is going to cover these charges, would it not be prudent for me to say, yeah, come down my quarter of a mile lane and go across my 50 feet of shale to get to my house and put it in, but I'm not going to use it?
Absolutely.
That's what I'm talking about. Will I not be assessed anything, or
nothing.
Will I
nope.
still be paying into the
nope.
capital?
No.
Nope.
No. Nope. Again, the capital
index fund.
There is no capital fund because the capital is all being paid 100% by DEP.
And in fact, we would prefer that you, that we prefer that you make that choice when we have all the equipment out there.
Oh, well, I understand that I would have to pay, and that's fair. I mean, I get that.
Oh, no, you wouldn't pay. No, no, we, no, no, you wouldn't pay. We would want to.
If I hook up now, but if I.
In the future.
In the future.
In the future, okay. So, I can opt out?
Yeah, sure.
Is my one?
Sure.
Still have the lines run?
Yeah, and it's up to you, you can run, adjust your.
And subdivide my property and have a hook up? It's kind of agricultural, it's certainly my hook up.
If the property's in the district.
Is the property's in the district, absolutely. Now, it would absolutely be eligible to be hooked up, so, but you would just, the only cost you would bear would be to run the copper off of.
So this little extra money on top of a water usage bill is a flat rate for everybody?
Understand, it's not going to be on top of, it's going to be a part of.
Oh, it's included in the water usage.
It's in the water.
So the water's supposed to be more.
The way we calculate water usage now for every water.
Can I say something, please? I am desperate to hear these two people's questions.
Thank you.
Please.
Okay, I think my questions are quite short.
Amy Donnelly, Locust Lane.
Russell, I was having a little trouble understanding you. Your speech was not as clear as I would have liked, but I understood you to say that the wells have returned to a baseline condition. The level is sort of at the starting point. If there's contamination, it's not due to the well test that took place in the spring. Is that correct?
Yeah, I wasn't even talking about quality. Certainly, water capacity is back where it was.
Okay, water capacity is back where it was, and. As far as you know, whatever the water quality is today is not going to be affected by any tests that you might do before the end of this year. Is that right? You're not going to do anything before the end of this year that would have an effect on the water quality.
I haven't been asked to do anything.
Okay. So, obviously, there are people who are planning to opt out. There are people who will raise questions. Just to find out, to tell you where I'm going with this. In the spring, there was a substantial drawdown in many people's wells and a change in quality in many other people's wells. People don't notice when their lead level goes up or their E. coli level goes up. But they do notice when there's a change in turbidity or odor, something like that. So after the first test was stopped abruptly, then there was a baseline test of water quality done. Then there was the second test and another test for water quality. When the town board declares itself lead agency, I would like to suggest that as soon as you declare yourself lead agency, that is before the end of this year, you do another set of baseline tests on water quality. I'll take the engineer's assurance that the levels have returned to their prior condition, but at a minimum, to test for lead, arsenic, E. coli, coliform, nitrates, and nitrates. Dan, am I missing some important health issues in that?
Me?
Yes? Is that, are those?
My health department would be.
Is that a minimal?
I think the list is the list that was sampled during the test.
Well, now arsenic was not included in the prior list. The reason I asked for arsenic was because there have been a lot of orchards in the area, and arsenic was formerly used to as an insecticide on fruit trees. I asked Dave Clouser to include arsenic along with the lead testing, which would have been done on the same bottle, very minimal extra charge, and he assured me he was going to ask you, but he didn't ask you, so I'm asking for it now. I would like the lead agency, in the process of gathering information, to take water tests on all the wells, whether people intend to opt out or not, and find out a few basic health parameters. I'm not talking so much about turbidity or odor, which were some of the things that were tested for before. If you want to test for those, that's fine. But I'm talking about the health condition of the water. I think it's something that you would need to know down the road. You could be sued if if somebody's well water has gone seriously wrong. So that would be my suggestion. The Seeker Act allows you to make a charge to the developer for that, but I think the charge would be modest. Am I correct that you could do 100 wells for a couple thousand dollars?
I don't have the charge. I mean, you just can take it into consideration and get back to ask you the question.
Last year, you told me that the test for the wells that were done was $4,000.
I don't recall that at all. They weren't, I can tell you that.
I can tell you they weren't.
Okay, well, can you give me a ballpark for what it would cost to test for E. coli, coliform, lead, arsenic, nitrates, and nitrates?
I can't, but I'm, because we'd have to pencil it out. I guess I'm curious to understand the logic behind your request. What would that establish in your mind?
It would create a baseline. If somebody already has arsenic in their well, in the first place, it would be good if they joined the water district and got onto municipal water where it was tested on a regular basis. Is that right, Mr. Mariello? All right.
Sounds good.
Sounds reasonable. But also, it would establish a baseline so that nobody could come up to you during the seeker process or after the seeker process and say, my well quality has changed. Just to get it, to find out what the initial conditions are before hundreds of thousands of gallons are pumped out. I think the cost of it would be very modest compared to the potential harm or the potential legal descriptions that would have to go on. I'm not even talking about potential suit, but just the legal description narrowing down what's in the water. So that's basically my question or comment. Is there any reason to think that DEP would not be amenable to paying for this if asked to by a lead agency?
Yeah, we would have to consider that, what, you know, what the project relevance is. These guys would have to us with an E.
Right, well, that does bring up one other point. You made an excellent presentation, promoted the maps and plans that you drew up very skillfully. But the seeker process can't have just one person, or just one side of a discussion coming forward with, well, this is how we're going to mitigate it. The whole point of the seeker process is that you need to have somebody else to say, well, is this mitigation adequate? You need to have some review. So I'm not happy with the idea that it would be the people who developed the project who would decide whether further testing for any possible mitigation is needed. Am I?
Yes. That makes sense. Yeah.
Thank you.
I just want to pick up one thread, and I know that we disagree on this, but given that this is all being recorded, let me just present the other perspective. I think, Amy, what you're suggesting is collect a round of water samples now after a year after the test has been done, because that would represent a fairer baseline of some sort representative of groundwater quality in the neighborhood.
It would certainly represent a fairer baseline than the initial tests that were done between the first and the second pumping activity.
Okay, so I just wanted to make sure that I understood that inference correctly, and just because we're all here on cable, I will just point out the opposing interpretation of the data, and I've heard you, and hopefully you'll just hear me. It's also documented in our report. It's clear, and there's no hiding, that there was a step test, there were some drawdown impacts that were significant, and that then two rounds of water samples were collected. Between those two rounds of water samples, there was also an extensive pumping test conducted that was more significant than the prior work, and between those two sample sets, there was no statistical difference in water quality when you looked at the averages across the neighborhood. And so in review with the health department and the DEC, and certainly my experience as a hydrogeologist where tests like that do not change the regional nature of groundwater, there was concurrence that those consisted and could be treated as typical water quality conditions. And I know that you disagree, and I know that there are people who disagree here, but I just wanted to say it so that both sides are aired in this meeting.
Well, I would strongly disagree with those facts as presented, but in any case, you're presenting one side, that's fine. As the lead agency, you have the responsibility to have an independent person come in and evaluate the plan that basically the developer of the plan is presenting to you. You can't just take his word for it, no change, this is how we're going to mitigate it. It's your legal responsibility to do that. And I would also point out that average water doesn't make any difference. That if you have to defend against the lawsuit, Mr. Moriello, saying that the average water quality in the neighborhood was unchanged is not going to go over very well in court, I believe. Even if there are only a few people who are affected, I think we need to know who they are.
I'll keep this short. My name is Dave Rosenberger, 8 Woodland Drive. I've been contacting a lot of you by mail. A lot of us in Woodland Drive do not have good wells. We're very much in favor of having a more reliable source of water. Point of information that I think some of you may find useful, the well that I have at 8 Woodland Drive is only 83 feet deep. If I water my garden, I routinely pump it dry. That may happen with those of you who try to use your own wells during the drawdown period. Charlie Nielsen installed a shutoff on my pump that shuts it off when it runs dry so that I don't ruin my pump, and therefore you could reliably use your wells and they would shut down without ruining equipment if you chose to use them during the shutdown period. A second point that I think a lot of us know, but perhaps not everyone, homes were built before, somebody tell me, 1985 had lead in the solder. So you may well end up with lead in your water as a result of the solder in your water pipes if your house is of that vintage. So if you test your own water and there's lead, it may be coming from your plumbing, not from your well. I have two questions. I'm a bit concerned that the question and answer indicated the town has the option, or the lead, I guess it's town, has the option of allowing homeowners to opt out, but it sounds like that's only an option until the board takes action. Can we be guaranteed that that option will be employed? If people finally agree to a water district, we definitely will have an opt out. Is that correct for those who choose not to connect?
That is correct.
Okay. And the second question had to do with the possibility that the aquifer would draw in either turbidity or sulfur or some other contaminant during the heavy draws. I assume that if that occurs, the treatment facility would be able to remove those problems, because by law you couldn't be distributing water that had an excess, let's say, sulfur level or whatever. Can you comment on that?
I can just say if there's something that shows up, say on the 10th week, that we don't expect, there'll be provision in the plant to be able to take a temporary treatment unit in and deal with it. We don't expect that, though.
Thank you.
John Farrow, 10 Locust Lane. What exactly needs to happen for the petition in the first scenario for this district to be created to be done? Is it a majority? Is it a majority of property owners, people on the deed, residents? How does that work? What constitutes a petition being a successful one for the creation of the district in scenario one?
Definitely the wrong one to answer that.
John, did you say your last name?
Farrell.
I think you're Laura.
Briefly, it would be by the resident owners owning taxable real property, aggregating at least one half of the assessed valuation of all of the taxable real property in the proposed district.
So two people are on one house of deed, and they, let's say, vote one way and the other one votes the other, what is the impact of that taxable property? What does it count for in it? Do you follow what I'm saying? How do you count each unit?
There's an answer. Dave Merzig?
Each individual who's on the deed has the right to have one vote.
So that would split the...
Correct.
Okay.
Right. Just like if one voted for the Republican and one voted for the Democrat, they kind of cancel each other out.
And so if through that process, then what's the count?
51%
of the assessed valuation. 51% of the owners of the assessed valuation.
Are you saying if I have a $400,000 assessment, my vote is worth $400,000?
Exactly.
And then you total that up and you get to 50% of the assessed value of the district? Okay.
Yeah. Correct. Yeah.
Is the same thing true for the permissive referendum?
I'm sorry?
Is the same thing true for the permissive referendum?
No, it isn't. No. No, it doesn't go on assessed valuation.
Gail Friedman, Plains Road. Russell, with all due respect, and I do respect your work, the results of the pumping test you said before primarily affected shallow wells closest to 101 Plains Road. But in point of fact, neighbors at the other end of the road with very deep wells saw their levels drop significantly, saw contaminants introduced into the wells. So it was not just a question of well depth and distance from the site. And therefore, the opt-out provision is very high risk for most people involved, which they may be misled into a false sense of confidence, I fear, by the way this was presented. Now, you've talked about other forms of mitigation and maintained that the district is the most viable one, but you also talked about the possibility of deepening shallow wells. But what we have been told in research and by DEC also is that, first of all, deepening the well is no guarantee that you will have capacity and or quality, and secondly, that it can be very difficult, if not impossible, to find contractors who are willing to do that because they fear that they're taking on liability. So those are things I'd like to respond to, whether tonight or at another point.
I'm delighted to respond to it. It's definitely not anybody's preference to go to that option. It is the reserve option, the recommended option, the preferred option for, without agreeing with everything that you say, but with agreeing with the concept of what you're saying, I think we're all in favor of a water district as a as an appropriate mitigation approach.
Yes, but if the neighborhood were to decide that it's not in favor of that, I raise this in the sense that there is still an obligation to provide mitigation, and raising issues with the secondary form of that mitigation that have been described here.
I've worked with drillers, their general preference is not to deepen a well, but I've also worked with them and they've deepened the well. So,
but there's also no guarantee, am I correct, that deepening that well will provide an effective mitigation?
What we would be looking to do, deepening wells, is to drill until we hit a minimum yield that would satisfy the need, and certainly in addition to deepen the water column, which that deepening the water column is, it couldn't be avoided effectively, because as you go deeper, there's going to be more water column.
Right, the wells that are almost 200 feet deep still saw their water level drop significantly and way more than the 20 feet that were described. I know somebody else raised that already. But that was true for the Criers. It was true at my house as well.
And yet didn't interrupt the yield, which I think supports the contention that deeper wells can handle quite comfortably a certain amount of drawdown without any interruption of capacity.
But interruption of quality, for sure.
As you just heard me discussing with Amy Donnelly, we completely disagree on the subject of quality.
The $125,000 that is being talked about, is that just for water use, or is that some of that money going to be allocated for maintenance and operations expenses also?
That is just for water use. That'll cover all of your bill. So the water use is everything. It's the water use, maintenance, and operations. So the 5 to 6 years would be covered by the $125,000.
So it's just for use, not for operations and maintenance?
It's for your whole bill. So
but is that amount of money to be allocated just for use, or is it also for the operations and maintenance, which are the variable expenses?
Your bill is based. So when you create bills, and we agree, look, twice since I've been on the board, we redone water rates. It rings a bell. It's based on your usage rate is based on all the cost. So you're asking. It will cover all of your costs of your water. So there's no direct bill for just water.
Right, that's not my question. Your 40 question and answer talked about the different components of the bill.
Right, yes.
And one component of the bill is your individual household water usage, and another component of the bill has to do with the maintenance of the water district.
Right.
And $125,000 is supposed to pay for however many years it lasts, for usage, but is any of that money also going to be allocated towards the operational expenses of the districts?
It's a fair question, but there's not a simple answer, and well, there is a simple answer, I guess. The answer is you will not get a bill. Now, your bill is always going to be based on the cost of the delivery of the water, which could include the operation and maintenance. Now, during the first 5 years, the operation of it is your water bill. We're not billing for the water. We're not paying for the water to come out of the ground. So it is the operation you're actually paying for. We don't have a per gallon, I don't have a charge by charging for the water in this. The charge is in delivering it to you. So it is covering all of your bills. So I guess then I should answer it as it is going to pay for both the operation and maintenance. There will be no maintenance in the first 5 years because of the way the contract is set. What we also discussed earlier this evening is we will be building, and Dave Merzig used much more proper words than I did, which is there will be a charge on all of the users, which will be built up to cover any unexpected maintenance. So we will have some of it is already built into the contract. We will have extra pumps sitting on the shelf. Should there be a catastrophe of some type, we will also have that fund to cover that.
Okay, will you lead me to the next question, because you talked about one of the other advantages if this water district were to go through was that if you had an emergency or an unanticipated event after DEP is done with its repairs, that this district would exist for that. However, you won't be permitted for that if you're only going to be permitted at 20 gallons per minute.
We would have to go out, and absolutely you're correct, we would have to go out and get other permitting for that. And I'm certain I would defer to the engineers that are here. I am certain if there was a catastrophe, if there was, again, I believe Dave mentioned it, which is, Mercy had mentioned it, which is if there was a catastrophe that was shut down the Catskill water supply, we only had a few days supply up in Catskill, up in our own reservoirs, the DEC and the Department of Health potentially would allow us to use
they'd
more
probably
water.
Grant a waiver, too. Yeah, I mean, in a situation like that.
Yeah, they were talking about a full-on catastrophe. Yes.
Well, this depending on the length of time, my point is there's been no safe yield established for that aquifer. So that would be another round of testing that would have to be done.
I couldn't answer that. I'd have to defer to our engineers to answer that question.
I have that from DEC. But final question. You're talking about running the lines down one side of the road. Inevitably, that will impact old growth trees, and the tree roots go under the road. They don't stop at the edge of the road. And if you're going to be going down one side of the road, it seems virtually guaranteed that some of those trees will be impacted, as well as people's properties, I might add. Is it not feasible to consider going down the middle of the road despite the traffic inconveniences? And would you consider bringing an arborist in to consult on this?
It depends on where the trees are, Gail. We want to not damage the trees if we have to move the line over into the road more. We would do that. One of the pieces of putting the water line on one side of the road is if there's ever a sewer line, it would go on the other. There's a separation distance that's required for that. That's kind of planning, infrastructure planning there. An arborist, we would certainly want to see what the condition of the trees are. There may be some that are not something that we need to be concerned about. There's others that certainly we would. But we would try to miss the trees. I mean,
well,
if we have to...
Well, obviously I know your intention is not to kill the trees. But one of the great quality of life things on Plains Road is that it has a particular environment and atmosphere, and the old growth trees are a large part of that.
So. I agree with that.
Yeah. Thank you.
If no one has any other questions, or did anyone here want to make any closing? No, we have one more question.
Yeah, just a comment and an observation. I'm going to use the microphone, but I also won't put my back to anyone when I speak.
What is your name, please, sir?
Bob Cashero. I live on 6 Schwango View. Just for the record, my well is about 140 feet deep. I do set back the distance from Plains to the cul-de-sac, and then maybe, I don't know, 30, 40 feet, and maybe 20-foot elevation below the level of the road. My well suffered insignificant drop in level during the testing. I think it was in the 6-foot range. I don't know if you guys have that kind of stuff in front of you. Immaterial. I was told that I had at least another 80 feet of water below, above the level I thought. So for me, this really isn't an issue of feeling threatened about my well, but it was 3 days. For those who feel threatened here, you've got to play with the cards that bring your hand. One of the cards in our hand is that the town can still do this, whether we vote for whether we approve the district or not. If they do, and if we don't, then we're all on our own for water. Should our wells, like mine, significantly drop after a 10-day period of this usage? That's an unknown. But it's an unknown I'm not willing to bet on or to gamble with. I'm tired of losing my water every time our power goes out, because of all of our beautiful trees on Plains Road that you bought in your lines, that then be mined underground, what for I don't know, utilities on Schwango View. My water's terrible. It has to be filtered, it has to be softened, it has to be treated, and I pay electricity for all of those appliances that do all of those things. I would like to be able to take my generator and hook it up to two other things other than my water pump.
which requires a double fee off my checker. All in all, I think the crux of the issue is, are you willing to take the risk that you're going to be okay? Or do you want to go into a plan which is going to guarantee you, by law, water? When the district is formed, the municipality and the DEP are required to provide us water. There's no guarantee that your well will continue to do so. So I think that probably, for me, is the main thought process. What are the facts? What are the risks? Now, there are a lot of controversy about reports that are questioning the science. Well, science is science. And I can believe most of the science. I don't know if there's any proof or correlation that drawdown inflicted upon these affected wells things like lead and the other pollutants. I don't know, but I'm not an engineer, and I'm certainly not a hydrogeologist. I don't know if that's possible. So by the way, I'd be interested to know that, if it is possible. The point remains, we don't know what will happen after 10 weeks. We saw what happened after the 3-day period, enough to make everybody shaky and to bring up all the good points. By the way, that both sides of this argument have raised, and I'm very thankful for both sides bringing up all of these points, because it really made me think twice about some of this. But for me, it all comes down to risk. Do I want to take the risk, or don't I, or would I like a guarantee? $18 a month, to me, does not sound like a horrible price to pay to guarantee water in the well. And with that, I want to thank you all for your attention.
I'd just like to point out that some of us have commented that $18 a month is a lot less than your cable service, and what comes in will be a lot less polluted.
That's good.
I think if we're good, we've made it to cable comments, we must officially be done. I think that is it. Anyone has any other questions or comments? Again, everything you saw presented tonight will be on the web. We'll have it on the web within, hopefully at latest by Monday, so we might get it to you tomorrow. So thank you, everybody.
Good job.
What did you say? Primary today, City of Kingston, I'm here in Shingo.
Oh, wow. What did you say?